broadcasting live from the Norman P. Murray Community Center in the heart of beautiful Mission Viejo. It's Breakfast with Gary and Kelly with special guest, Saxman extraordinaire, Eric Marienthal.
It's about time you showed up.
I think I had a bad hot toddy.
Stop it.
Welcome to Breakfast with Gary and Kelly, everybody. How's it going? Thanks, most of you are on time.
We are so glad that you are here. This
does
is
it look
our
like the holidays?
It does, and this is our third year. We are closing out on 3 years. Can you believe that?
Yeah.
And the next year will be 4 years. How about that?
It's amazing how you did that.
I know.
That was remarkable.
Well, we started in January, 3 years ago. So this coming January will be 4 years.
You got any more of this?
Introduce our guest.
We've got a great one to wrap up the third year. I'll tell you.
Awesome.
This is a guy who's a great supporter of this radio station. He's a great supporter of a lot of needy folks in the community as well.
Exactly.
Not to mention the fact that he's just a brilliant, brilliant musician. And we're thrilled to have him here today. Please welcome Eric Marienthal.
Thank you.
Great stuff. Eric Marienthal, thank you, sir.
Outstanding.
Stick around, you're waiting to chat with Eric Marienthal all this hour on Breakfast with Gary Kelly. Great stuff, man.
Great job.
Welcome back here to Breakfast with Gary Kelly, everybody, with Eric Marienthal, who wisely doesn't trust anyone on our staff to keep an eye on his sax for him.
Wants to hold it and hold it.
Exactly. Well, my wallet is bound to turn up soon, so I think you're okay. Thanks for being here, man. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas to you, too. Thank you.
This is...
Did you get your gym?
I did get my gym. Look at this. I have to tell you, we got... Kelly and I got handed this by Eric this morning when he showed up. It's the spiced pear jam made with love from the Marienthal family, 2005. So this is kind of old, but no, I'm kidding. 2013. You're blowing out some old stock, were you? No.
It stays forever.
As long as it's not unsealed, I'm pretty sure probably that's what they did.
Thank you, Miss Hot Toddy. You made this.
I made it with my own hands. Yeah, last week, by the way. Not 2005. What do you say?
I know. I'm kidding.
It's been a Marienthal tradition for years and years. And the tradition somehow ended up... Originally it was Leanne, my wife, making it, and then I volunteered one year to make one of the batches.
Oh, see, that was your first mistake right there.
And then somehow the shift of responsibility with the jam making, you know.
How much of this do you make?
Yeah, how many?
We have a large family.
How many of those things do you fill?
About 100 and a little over 100.
Now, let me ask you this. Do you grow your own fruit for the...
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
You do?
Yeah, we have a whole pear orchard in the backyard. And
Mitch is in charge of... nice. Right.
Well, some
He's in charge
people
of the cinnamon.
Oh, is that what it is? Yeah, nice. The farm. Cinnamon acreage.
Yeah.
Yeah, right. Very nice.
He's great at it.
You never know.
That's crazy. Well, good for you. That's a fun thing.
What else do you
That's
make?
That's a very old-fashioned deal.
We do a whole thing. Leanne makes killer granola. Mm. And one year she made soap. And
you don't eat that, though.
Yeah, it's dangerous.
Carving the Christmas
safer.
Soap is really not the
well,
same thing.
Well, we've got
thing.
A lie going on, and it's a very, it's a science experiment,
Ooh.
And, being around anything where if you put your hands in the wrong thing, your hands aren't going to come out the same way they came in,
No way! So.
I just was doing that a few minutes ago with Kelly's cooking segment, as a matter of fact, so...
Nice!
Oh, stop.
That is not true.
He's joking.
You can make a special recipe for him.
I know, I will.
That's really cool. Christmas is... How old are your kids now? Because I think yours and ours are right kind of in the same ballpark. Robert and...
Robert is 24. And Katie's 27.
Wow.
Isn't that crazy?
Leanne and I just celebrated our 30th anniversary.
Oh, did you really? Congratulations. Oh, congratulations. Yay. Oh, that's neat.
Of course, we added up the, if you add up the number of days we've actually been together over those 30 years, it comes out to about a year and a half.
Which is really the key.
Yeah.
That's the key.
And that's her on your CD, right?
Exactly. Yeah, that's her
on
that
CD. Hold that CD up, Gary.
That is, yeah. This is Sweet Talk. And that
I just think that's the most sexiest photo ever.
Favorite photo shoot of all time.
Oh, I would think.
She's got gorgeous hair. Yeah, beautiful. Yeah, she also made chocolate chip cookies one time.
Oh, she
did. The bash. They were really
that
good.
She actually kind of had to stop doing the oatmeal chocolate chip cookies for a while because, every time I would do a gig, she would, make
bring
cookies.
Bring them,
for
I know. We were expecting
so,
them.
Yeah, it was
like, where's Leanne at?
What, there's no cookies? Are you kidding? We're not playing until we get the cookies. Forget it.
I could see that happening.
That's funny. Wow. Let's walk through your career a little bit. You're a Boston Berkeley guy. You're a California guy before that. But how? Tell me, we've had so many people in that seat that have gone through Boston Berkeley School of Music. What is it about that place that is different and unique and so special?
Well, the history of the school, it's pretty... pretty remarkable, the number of musicians who've gone through there, and I didn't really know much about it one before going, quite frankly, except for the musicians who have been there and just seeing all these different people. But I was living with a friend of mine in high school, actually, I was a junior and he was a senior. I was with his family. And he was going. And we just, you know, that next year, when you know, I was a senior looking at mm-hmm. schools, we just kept talking, and he was telling me how great it was, how much fun he was having. And I had never been farther east than Las Vegas prior to that. And so when
Boston when I, had the wholesome appeal then too, for sure.
Oh, for sure, yeah. And when I first went, I mean, I moved to Boston, and I, you know, all of my worldly possessions were in this little cab, you know. So the cab driver, you know, drops me off on, you know, the corner of Mass Ave and Boylston in Boston, and it's, you know, especially back then, it was kind of funky, you know.
Yeah.
And,
what time of year
Berkeley,
was it?
It was, you know, beginning of school, I guess September.
Okay.
And
I was thinking how cold it was.
Well, it got cold, yeah. I mean, just
because from a California guy going back east, it gets kind of cold.
Oh man. Oh yeah. The first winter, it didn't get above zero for the first 6 weeks.
Oh well. Yeah.
There was a digital thermometer at the bank building across the street, and there was always a minus sign. And then one day, finally, it out of the blue, it went up to 38 degrees.
Oh wow.
Sweet.
We were outside with our shorts and flip flops.
It's true. No, it's true, isn't it? Yeah. You get used to it, man. In those days, it's so funny. Yeah. It's so funny.
But it's great. I mean, Berkeley is just, you know, it's a conservatory. So especially back then, there was just two buildings in the middle of the town. Of the city. So when they dropped me off, I was just on the curb with my boxes and suitcase and, you know, like, really? This is college? You know? This doesn't look like the brochure. Wait a second.
Not the brochure. Well,
yeah, the timeshare. How did you get hooked up first? Your first real connection, though, when you got out of school, was Al Hurt?
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah. I came back to Los Angeles and just got a very inexpensive apartment, not an apartment, a room in a house, actually, kind of a boarding house of sorts. And I got a busboying job. And when I wasn't working, I was practicing, much to the chagrin of the other people in the house. But then I heard about auditions for, Al Hurt was auditioning for a big band that he was gonna have based in New Orleans, but he was auditioning in Los Angeles, so I went to the auditions. And I got the gig along with a bunch of my friends, so, yeah, it was pretty amazing. I was 21 years old. And
really?
And, so we moved to New Orleans, and during the week we played at Al Hurt's Club on the corner of St. Louis and Bourbon Streets.
Oh, in
the
man.
French Quarter. And then almost every weekend we would travel to some other city, you know, Chicago one weekend.
Had you been to New Orleans before?
No. Oh, heck no.
Oh man.
How fun is that?
Oh, so yeah. There's your first time there. Playing with Al Hurt, did you? How you had to have Al Hurt on your radar? I mean, you knew who he was and everything.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, he was a legend. I mean, you know, there were, yeah. I mean, it was pretty funny. You know, that was after. I don't know if you remember the story about when he was the Grand Marshal of the Mardi Gras. One year, he was on the float and somebody threw a brick and hit him right in the mouth.
No, you're kidding. I don't remember that at all.
And so. So that didn't do a whole lot for his trumpet playing, obviously. But he came back, and he was, you know, but he had other
horrible
health issues. So, you know, but, you know, he was he wasn't quite himself. But one night, Doc Severson came and sat in with us. And back then, this is early, you know, the early 80s, so we had this arrangement of Rocky, which back then was really hip, you know. And so he played, and before, you know, Al was playing. He was playing, you know, not incredible like he used to, but, you know, still good. Huh. And so Doc Severson sat in, and he played the first chorus, and just sounded incredible. And you could just tell that Al Hurt was thinking to himself, well, I'm not going to let this little, you know what, you know, show me up. And he just, like,
just really
brought it. And we were looking at each other like, where the heck has that been, you know? So it was remarkable. Wow. He was the greatest guy.
Oh.
How funny.
How did you pick the saxophone to play? I mean, when was it when you started your musical path?
I was nine.
9 years old?
Fourth grade. And some friends of mine and I, you know, went to the assembly where the music teacher came around and said, whoever wants to play an instrument can go and rent the instrument and join the beginning band. And she laid all the instruments out on the table, and there were violins and trombones.
Did you try other ones, or did you just...
No, I wanted to play trumpet.
Oh.
Because that was a man's instrument.
Okay. You know?
And she said, well, are you going to be getting braces? I guess I had funky teeth. And she said, you can get braces. And I said, well, Yeah, I am. And she said, you know, that's probably not a great idea. You're going to be a bloody mess if you, you know, try
really?
To come up with, you know.
With braces.
So she, is there anything else that interests you? And we looked at each other and we said, that one looks pretty cool, you know. And we pointed to an alto sax. And I had, none of us knew, you know,
what it was.
Sounded like. But
yeah.
So, yeah, that's it. And then in high school, I was getting pretty serious with it. I think I was a freshman, and my music teacher said I should go buy a better, yeah. you know, better
and
instrument.
And this is the one that you...
And this is the one.
That you've yeah. had since high school?
Wow, really?
Ta-da!
Wow. And it's still playing after all these years.
Yeah, everybody always, you know, looks at it and says, wow, what a cool antique.
Yeah, you ain't kidding.
And the horn's nice, too.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah, right, exactly.
Were you in the marching band in high school?
Unfortunately.
Yeah. You were? You were in the marching band?
I had to be. Oh, you know, that was like P.E. So,
oh.
you know,
yeah, right.
if you were still in high school when you were 18, you know, back then you didn't have to be in P.E. anymore. So everybody, you know, like was counting down the days to their 18th birthday. Not because they could go out and be adults, but because we didn't have to be in marching band anymore.
Oh.
You know, that's a you know,
oh, wow.
Exaggeration. It was actually a lot of fun. All, you know, we were all
So
friends.
Your first band, when was that? Were
my
you in high school?
First, yeah, no, and first band I played in was, first outside of school, was a trumpet player, a friend of mine, Greg Preckle, put together a band called Preckle's Plumbers.
Say that again.
Wow.
No, I'm not going to say it again. But there was a tuba player and a trumpet player and me and...
Plumbers.
They, hello, plumbing. You know, oh. His dad came up with it. I don't
know. Oh, hey.
But we played...
So early corporate sponsorship game, right? Nice, exactly.
That's right. We played an ice cream social when I was in fifth grade. And so, you know, the sponsor must have been, you know, I don't know, basketball.
What kind of music?
You know, I mean, probably, you know, Dixieland.
I mean, it's pretty
knows.
Much wide open with a name like that. You know, you can pretty, you
yeah.
know.
Yeah, well, it's true. Although we had all been playing for about 9 months, so, you know, to have called it music, that was a bit of a stretch, I would imagine, you know.
Oh, man. When did you start getting really serious, though? High school?
Yeah, probably eighth grade. I started, you know, there was a band of sophomores at the high school who were looking for a sax player, and somehow they were interested in me. So that, you know, so my band director came to me during rehearsal and said, you know, there's kind of excitedly, there's some guys from the high school that want to come hear you play. They're considering having you join the band. I said, really, me?
Wow.
And so I joined their band, and we played, you know, we played gigs, we played parties and
nightclubs.
Yeah,
right.
That was back in my big drinking days. But, yeah. 13-year-old drinking days.
Do you remember a time when you the light kind of went on and you said, "This is something I can really do or want to do for, you know, for a career"? Has that not happened yet?
Yeah, still waiting to figure out what I want to do.
Yeah.
Well, partly. I remember when I was a freshman in high school with those guys. Actually, we were driving somewhere, and one of the guys kind of made this. Announcement said, you know, I want to become a professional musician. I want to do this, you know, and this is fun. It's what I want to do. And that's, you know, there I was in the backseat of the car, 15 years old. Yeah, I want to do that too. It's
great. I don't know if I had my driver's license too.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, as I finished paying off my horn.
Yeah.
But yeah, and then when I, you know, it's kind of one of those things where you keep. You know, people say, hey, you're pretty good, you should join that band. Hey, you're pretty good, you'd be in a high school band. Hey, you're pretty good, you should go to college and, you know, keep playing.
Did your parents ever express concern about, get a real job?
No, I was pretty much on my own by the time any of those discussions came around anyway. But no, it was, you know, earlier on, it was certainly, you know, do what you enjoy doing.
Yeah.
That's what we've always tried to tell.
Were they musical in any way?
No, I'm the only musician.
Really?
I have two older brothers and
really?
They're nowhere near it. And, no, just me. Yeah.
How interesting. What about your kids?
Yeah, very much so. My daughter graduated from USC with a musical theater degree.
Oh,
wow.
Of course, now she's almost finished with acupuncture school, so she's...
She can do it while she's singing, you know?
Yeah.
Musically inclined.
But yeah, so musical theater.
So you do have to go to school for that.
For theater?
For acupuncture.
Yeah,
I thought, really.
And Leanne and I have both been, over the years, the guinea pig.
Oh. You know.
Great.
Yeah. Practice.
Yeah. Great.
Is it here? No.
Oh, man. Well, and then it's a good thing she's not a surgeon. Then.
Yeah. And Rob plays guitar. In fact, they both played at High Hope's benefit that we do every year.
Oh, nice. So nice. Have fun.
Well, we're going to talk about that a little bit later.
Yeah, we sure definitely. Are. We sure are. We played the song for Mark's daughter before.
Oh, yeah.
She's incredible. Eric Marienthal is our guest here this morning. Obviously, we're going to take a little break and come back and have him put that horn to use. You know what I'm saying? So stick around here on Breakfast with Eric Marienthal. Welcome back to Breakfast with Gary and Kelly, everybody. Did you meet Mitch Foreman back here, the great Mitch Foreman?
Say hello to Mitch. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thanks for being here, man. You could make good use of about $20 if you bought Sing Along with Mitch, because that's a great CD. It really is. This is a real talented guy, right, Eric?
Yeah.
But God, this morning has been like that all day long. All right, I'll shut up now. You play for us, please. What are we going to hear?
Oh, we're going to hear one that I wrote with the great Jeff Lorber for my new record.
That would be the Grammy-nominated one?
Yes.
The Grammy-nominated one?
Yeah. Woo! Hello. Grammy Award.
We should have introduced him like that.
I know.
But we will remember that one now.
Yeah. All
right. Here we go. Eric Marienthal.
Thank you.
stick around here. Breakfast is getting going.
Don't go away.
That's fun stuff, man. Welcome back to Breakfast with Gary and Kelly, everybody.
Woo.
Nice.
What was that song? What was that last one?
St. Thomas.
Ah, very nice.
That's a great song.
Yeah,
that's
that
a
is.
Great song. Who wrote that?
Sonny Rollins.
Ah. Yeah, great Sonny Rollins. That's one of those deals that it's like, what has it been used as the music for? The Muppets or something a bunch of times, hasn't it? One of those deals, something like that? Oh, look, yesterday was Eric's birthday, everybody. Did we know that?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Eric Marienthal. Happy birthday to you.
Nice. Nice.
Make a wish.
Thank you, Mitch. Thank you, girl.
Cake for everybody.
Exactly.
Yeah. Oh. I mean, yes.
Just for you.
Nice,
thank you.
Very nice.
Foreman jumped in there, too. Yeah, baby. Nice.
It doesn't pay any extra, so.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll double your pay for that. But yeah, right. Exactly. Exactly.
Oh, fun.
You get a piece of cake.
Yeah. So what did you do yesterday on your birthday, Mr. Grammy nominee?
I
You had your staff.
Jam.
Oh, nice.
That's what I did.
Let's talk about the Grammy.
Yes.
Have you been nominated before?
Well, I mean, it pays to be in good bands, put it that way. I've never been nominated under my own name, but been nominated twice with the Chick Corea Electric
Band. Oh, of course.
And we won one, matter of fact. And then once with GRP Records had a big band, an all-star big band, they called it.
Yeah.
We were nominated one year. And then several times with the Gordon Goodwin Big Fat Band.
Well, that's a fun deal, isn't
those
it?
Those guys are.
Boy, those are some great players. Great players.
Yeah.
Well, congratulations. I mean, that really is a fun
thing.
Talk about
the actual album that got
well, nominated. It's the Jeff Lorber Fusion record.
Okay.
It was nominated for Best Pop Instrumental Performance.
Very nice.
Pop album, I should say. You know, the categories were narrowed this year, so we thought, because we were nominated 2 years ago.
Now, do you put it in that category, or do they do that?
We did.
Okay.
Yeah, we did. I mean, we try to put it in, the album of the year, but they just said,
That's okay. No, because I was saying, because pop, I mean, and it's a... I mean, jazz, kind of like a instrumental thing.
Yeah, therein lies contemporary jazz court category went away for some unknown reason.
Yeah.
So
I saw that.
Suddenly we're
and
we're
what's
pop
funny is you're in
artists.
Some interesting company too, in that whole lineup of nominees.
Yeah.
A lot of people that we know. I'm like, oh, really? Pop? Really? Pop? Wow.
I know, yeah.
I would never expect it.
Yeah,
I mean,
no, the Earl Clue solo record was nominated. And the
Dave Koz and the Horns.
And the Horns record.
It's like, pop, okay.
Will you attend the...
I'm actually going to Europe that night, so I may not be able to go to the stable show. But the pre-telecast where they actually, the jazz or the instrumental stuff goes on.
That's
obviously, off camera, the day of.
Were they doing it at Denny's or what? Are they?
No. They have a ballroom.
Yeah, that would be an upgrade. No, they do. Actually, we were nominated two records ago, and we, got to go with the whole thing.
Yeah.
And I went, the what you get is two great seats, to the whole thing,
ooh,
the party beforehand, the day before, and all the things. So. So at the stable show, we had seats right, in front of it. And, they had different areas where people would present. And Jennifer Lopez was on one little island where, she introduced,
right,
a performer or whatever. So during the live telecast, they have the commercial breaks. And whenever there's a commercial break, people get up and it's a big scurry. You have a couple minutes if you're going to go to the bathroom or whatever.
Kind of like
so,
here.
So J-Lo does her thing and comes walking down. And I'm sitting in an aisle seat. And as she's doing this, it goes to commercial. And suddenly There are, you know, throngs of people going into the you know, little walkway there.
Yeah.
Important to note at this point that she was wearing a very short dress.
Uh-oh.
And
uh-oh.
I was sitting down about here.
Oh, no.
Keep that information here for later. So, so she's walking down here, and people come next to her and push her kind of, you know, this way, and suddenly J-Lo is here. And, of course, my wife sitting next to me is here. So
I believe the term is entrapment.
So I'm thinking to myself, look forward.
You're a wise, wise man, Marienthal. I love that about you.
Thank you. I want to make it to my 31st.
Yeah, exactly right. Exactly right. Oh, that's funny. That would be cool. Well, I hope you win. I hope you win. That would be a fun. So a band project thing. There you go. Would you all get Grammy? Nice.
Yes. Yeah. It's just three of us: Jimmy Haslip,
right.
And Jeff and myself. So we would. Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome.
How exciting! Good for
you, man. Tell the Chicory story. It's unbelievable. You know, I mean, how the planets line up and stuff, isn't it?
When I started playing with Chick?
Yeah, yeah. How that kind of came about?
Yeah, it was 1986, and I was working. I'm going to say this right here in public, aren't I? I was working in the Disneyland band.
Aww.
There's nothing to be ashamed about.
I worked at Disneyland.
I know.
You say that with a smile.
Anyway, it was a great job. It was a great, you know, great, great company to work for, and it was a steady job.
Yeah.
And, you know,
again, good benefit.
Playing all the time.
Yeah.
I
so, yeah, it was 5 days a week. You know, worked every... You know, all the time. And so...
Nice uniform.
I was... Thank you. Okay, it's enough. Yeah, don't talk about the fez or, you know...
I like the feathers. It's cute.
So I was, you know, the... Actually, one of the nice things was that we could do other things. We could sub, you know, send other people to do... Take our place if we had other things to do, other work. And so I would play every Monday night at this jazz club in L.A. And so we were playing away and it was, you know, funky little... club, and the front door opens, and we can see the front door from the stage, and I see the silhouette, and I'm looking, thinking, wow, that looks a lot like Chick Corea. How weird is that, you know? Mm-hmm. And then he got closer, I said, oh, my God, it is Chick Corea. And he had his whole entourage, and make a long story short, he knew the piano player, John DeVello, who we were playing with. He came up and sat in with us, and, you know, I'm just like,
Oh, my God.
And he said, you know, 500 Miles High, one of his songs, and I said, yeah, of course, let's play that. So we played that together. So we talked afterwards, and he was complimentary, and it was all great. And went home, went back to Disneyland the next day. And so there was a break room with a phone. This was before cell phones, you know. And we happened to be on break, and the phone rings, and the bass player goes and answers it. And he, with this dumbfounded look on his face, says, Eric, the phone's for you. And I said, as I'm walking up, I said, who is it? And he says, well, he says it's Chick Corea.
Whoa.
And all the conversation in the room, it was as if a vacuum just sucked, you know, it was like...
Oh, quiet.
And so I went to the phone and I said, hey, Chick. How the hell did you get this number?
Yeah, really?
I told you, I'm working here, call me back. Yeah, right.
No. Actually, he called my house. I've never forgiven my wife for, you know, for saying to Chick Corea when he calls me at home, oh, no, Chick, he's not here. He works in the Disneyland band.
And did he go to Disneyland? Had to find you.
Oh, God.
Credibility.
Oh.
You know. So he says, you know, hey, I like the way you played last night. I was there because I want to add a saxophone player to the band, and you know, you're it. Would you like to, you know, join the band? We're
and you said
in the middle of the record right now, and when the record is done, we start a world tour. We start in South America and on from there. What do you think?
And you're like, I got
Disney 2 weeks notice.
What does it pay? I mean, that has benefits.
Yeah, or, right, exactly.
So, you know, I said, incredible, absolutely, yeah. So at this
point,
like everybody,
how old were you?
25.
Oh,
so everybody's at that point, like, you know, listening, wah, 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 you know. So I put the phone down and look around at everybody and I say, I quit.
What did Leanne say? What did your wife say?
Oh, she was fine with it.
Okay.
Yeah.
I was just gonna say, she go with you and travel the world?
Yeah, we actually did. Ironically, we had Katie, who was 6 months old at that point, and she came to New Orleans.
Oh.
We were in New Orleans playing for, I don't know, 3 or 4 days.
Uh-huh.
So she came, you know, braved an airplane. Yeah, I remember it was this funky club called Tipitina's, and it was a it was more of a rock club, but they had some jazz acts, and it was two levels. And on the top level, there was chicken wire to make sure people didn't fall out.
Oh,
and
there
nice. Was, you know, that's always nice. Yeah. That's what I look for in a fine club.
Yeah,
really.
I know. But it was, you know.
Chicken wire.
But first class chicken wire.
Honestly, yeah, well, they're really
high quality.
You got to stick with the brand name chicken wire. You can't go with that off market stuff.
No.
You know?
Yeah, you gotta be careful with your chicken wire.
That's right. Oh, that's a great story. Had he truly, I mean, did you ever find out, I mean, had he heard about you before he came into the club, or was it truly just one of those things, he just kind of came in?
We had met one time before at a festival in Washington, D.C., and then John Petitucci, the bass player in the band, a good friend of mine and Mitch's and all of ours, wasn't the band, and when Chick mentioned it, he said, "Oh, you know, you should check out Eric, you know." And I think he's playing at this place.
Wow!
So,
yeah. How fun!
That's
fun!
That's exciting.
Those first few shows had to just be—you just had to be on cloud nine.
Well, actually,
or not.
Well, I definitely was the very first show. It was a lot of music, and we had to memorize everything, and it was just, you know, a lot. It wasn't just, you know. You know, it wasn't
playing and jamming.
It was some intense music. And so the first show we had was at Symphony Hall in Minneapolis. And, you know, it went great. And so the next morning, I went for a walk. And this guy stops me on the street and says, "You played at Symphony Hall last night with Chick Corea, right?" And I said, "Yeah." He said, "Man, you were incredible. You're one of the most incredible musicians I've ever heard in my entire life." I said, "Wow, thank you so much. It was my first gig with Chick. I can't tell you how much I appreciate that." And he says, "Yeah, by the way, what kind of bass was that you were playing?"
Aww.
There you go.
And I said, "Actually, I was the sax player." And he goes, "Oh, well, you were good too."
That sounds like something I would say. That's so Kelly.
Oh, man.
I had that too.
That's unbelievable. Yeah.
Well, at least you remembered your face.
Yeah, we look a little bit alike, so yeah, didn't remember it quite well enough, but yeah.
Very good.
That's so funny. How long were you with him?
Let's see, about 25 years. We played
24 years.
Well, the band never actually officially stopped. Chick is just so prolific, and so he does so many different things. We played a week at the Blue Note in New York 2 years ago for Chick's 70th birthday.
Wow. That must have been awesome.
Yeah,
that's got to be just special.
And of course, you took pictures.
There's a couple other shows like that that you remember from those days. I mean, there's got to be a few that just jump out like crazy, huh?
Well, yeah, mostly Chick. There was one show we did in Sao Paulo, Brazil, and it was Free was the name of the company that sponsored, but it was a free festival, and it was on a Sunday afternoon in a park, and we had done the sound check. It was a big giant park. In the morning, and so we came back in the afternoon to the concert, and the stage was on a little hill, and we approached it from the back, so we didn't see the audience until we literally walked out on stage. We walk out there, and they said there were between 75 and 85,000 people, and it was just looking out, you know, just
sea of people,
and all standing up, so all you see were heads. And,
in Brazil.
In Brazil, yeah. And of course, we get out there, and Fran's guitar player goes, you know, and nothing. You know,
oh, really?
No sound, yeah. Like, really? Today? You couldn't do that at the club we did, you know, yesterday.
Oh, man.
It ended up being a quick fix, but...
That's kind of scary.
I'm sure he lost a year or two on that one.
Oh, my God.
Unbelievable.
How crazy.
Give us a couple minutes about High Hopes. This is a real labor of love for you for a good number of years. Crazy how long?
20 years, isn't it?
It's more than 20.
More than 20.
Well, we've been doing the concerts. Last year was our 15th annual concert this summer, July 20th, as a matter of fact. It will be our 16th. It's just been such a true labor of love. Mark Desmond, the director of High Hopes, has been, it's a place of miracles. It's located in Tustin. It's a place where people go who have suffered traumatic brain injuries, and they just do miraculous things for people who have either run out of insurance, where mm-hmm. they just can't go any farther, or doctors say,
no hope.
You've kind of gone as far as we can yeah. go. You know, you're kind of on your own. That's point, it. Basically. And so they, the success stories that they've had are nothing short of miraculous, especially exactly. with people who have been told yeah. that they'll never speak again, never walk again, every story is different, from bicycle exactly. accidents to all sorts of things. And so, and it's a nonprofit, so they, mm-hmm. it's just remarkable. I encourage people to go check out the website, right. Which is, I should know by now, www.highhopes.ws for website.
Right. Oh, right. Yeah. Good yeah. stuff. And they're great shows, and you've pulled in some remarkable folks. And
last summer we had Johnny Mathis.
Oh, I know. Yeah. Yeah. Johnny Mathis and Debbie Boone.
Brian Culberson. Mm-hmm. Chuck Lowe, Mitch was there. Yeah. Done it a whole bunch of times.
You had who was that a couple years ago? It was I forgot.
The second year we did it.
Shouldn't have had that third toddy.
Yeah, right.
I'm sorry.
We had Lou Rawls.
That was it.
Yeah, the late Vesta Williams sang one day, and yeah. it won that one. And Lou Rawls, I met him that night, and he said to us, he came to hear Vesta. He said, you know, it's great to be here. I'm here to see you, and here to support the cause. I really don't want to sing, so don't call me out. And so, sure enough. The second set, Vesta says, and ladies and gentlemen, we have a celebrity here in the audience, Mr. Lou Rawls. And come on down, Lou. Come on, sing a song.
Oh, God, no, really?
And the crowd goes crazy. And my father-in-law was actually doing the spotlight uh-huh. for us. And he's like, perusing the audience to find Lou Rawls.
Oh, man.
And it took about 20 seconds. And I'm thinking, oh, great. He left. And so he's gone, and the crowd's going nuts, and the show is just going to tank now because, oh, great.
Oh, no.
And sure enough, he stands up and comes down and does this whole, he does a couple of numbers, and
wow.
Incredible. I mean,
how fun. Yeah. How fun.
Amazing.
Eric, this is
it's gone by too fast.
It really is. We're gonna take a break, though, and come back and get another song out of you, if you don't mind.
Happy to.
Please, stick around, please, and Breakfast with Gary and Kelly. Welcome back to Breakfast with Gary and Kelly, everybody, with Eric Marienthal. Just realize this CD is already, 10 years old, hard to believe.
That particular one, yeah.
Yeah, it is.
It's Love is my new one.
It's, pardon me?
It's Love.
Yes, it is. The new one, which we don't have.
But we will.
Because it's slow, they can't make them fast enough, right?
Sold out.
That must be it. That must be it. Thanks so much for being here. Mitch, thank you, too, again. Yes. Always, Ben. Great player.
So what are you guys going to play?
Appreciate it.
What you going to play?
Oh, we're going to play the great Billy Joel tune, New York State of Mind.
Oh, yeah, man. Ooh, yeah, baby.
It. Yay!
Eric Marienthal. Thank you.
got chills. Woo! Eric, can I get you up here? Come up here.